Yes, sir!
We're back. Three
LBC
weeks
is
in
back
action.
Up in effect. We've been gone for the last 2 weeks, people. And thanks for dropping on in. Hey, we got a lot of stuff we're going to talk about, people, because we got a lot of info that we're going to break down. So let's go ahead and start it out. We got B-Shadow, the architect in the building.
What's up, people? We are back, and we're ready to go.
We got Ryan Parks, the number one.
What's up, everybody?
We got Swaggy P. No introduction.
Yo, I'm chilling and I'm playing NBA Live. You know what's up?
Yeah. And we got Stan the Professor.
What's good, Law Community, man? Let's get it cracking.
Yeah, you already know who I am. I'm Prime. I'm the Godfather right now. We got one member missing. We got Stan the Informer right now. He's unavailable. He's at work right now making that cash, making that loot. But anyway, we're going to talk about some. Go ahead and get this popping. So the first thing that we're going to talk about is that there's been a lot of stuff. We're going to talk about differences between the live community, the 2K community, what are some of the practices that EA need to stop doing. We also have some stuff with the mocap. We also have some other stuff that we're going to break down some of our feelings and what it is that we feel. So what we're going to do, what we're going to start off is that we're going to start off with Swag. He got some stuff that he want to talk about. So we're going to talk about the mocap and everything, how everything going down with that. So we're going to start off with Swag on that, and then we're going to move over to Shadow. All right?
Oh, well, it's great to be back with the NBA Live Veteran Committee once again. A lot of things have transpired in the past 3 weeks of our absence, and I will quickly try to summarize what those activities are as we move along in this show. Well, as you may know, there was a 2K transient that entered into the NBA Live community and brought NBA Live 16 a lot of attention. He went by the name of Los Pollos TV. Shout out to him. As a result of him being banned from the 2K community, he decided to play NBA Live 16, stream it, and try out Live Ultimate Team, in which he had a very positive review of Live Ultimate Team and its gameplay and content. There was some controversy that took place amongst the NBA Live community supporters and some of the interactions that took place between the NBA Live developmental team. One person in particular, I'm not going to mention any names, reaching out to this individual for feedback. There's a clash that has been evaluated and has been a source for outrage and uprising in the NBA Live community, and we will discuss that as we move along in the show. There were some polls that were also that were also brought forth in the past 3 weeks when we were absent. Prime had a very wonderful poll elaborating upon aspects of Lord have mercy. What is it again, Prime? What's your poll that featured?
I'm going to go ahead and show it. It was two polls. One was for what are some of the main significance of what EA need to focus on, and the other one was the I forgot that.
I know this is the same.
It's two of them. It's on there. I will go ahead and pull it up. You know, go ahead.
Yeah, Prime also had two polls. I had a poll that emphasized particularly on what aspects of gameplay do you feel were exploits for NBA Live 16, whether they were hook shots, layups, three-point shooting, pick and roll, off-ball screens, and, of course, alley-oop passing, in which the community felt that hook shots and layups were an exploit in the game, and second were alley-oop passing, third were third was pick and roll, off-ball screens, and fourth was three-point shooting. And then there's another poll that is active right now on my Twitter page at SwaggyP_Lino, in which you could discuss whether or not you would pre-order NBA Live 17 now. It is a close race. A lot of individuals have chosen to pre-order NBA Live 17 now, even though there aren't any evidence specifically towards gameplay. Some believe that they would pre-order the gameplay after the release of the demo. Some also believe that they would buy the game after its release. And then there's a significant amount of individuals who say there's no purchase or nothing that they will do to buy the game. So it's an interesting poll. There's over 200 votes on it. Go ahead and check that out at SwaggyP_Lino, and we would elaborate upon those things as well. For mocap, we're going to discuss, like we did in the last show, how encouraged we are about the developmental process of mocap coming back into Live 17. Are we excited about it? Do we feel as if this is promising for the franchise? We know that there are members of the Harlem Globetrotter team that has been introduced into the mocap sessions, which is a very good thing for me because these are very skilled individuals who can imitate almost anyone in the league and carry out almost any maneuver necessary to fulfill whatever animation needs need to be placed into the game. As far as everything else in community activity, like I said, the number one uprising, it's kind of hard talking on the fly. The uprising, is, of course, is the community outlash to a particular individual from the NBA Live developmental team immediately seeking fellowship from a 2K transient who entered into the NBA Live community and was asking for their feedback. We're going to chime into that. I got my opinions about that. I'm sure everybody else in the panel have their opinion about that. But that is just a summary as to what has been going on in the NBA Live community in the 3 weeks that we've been absent. Back to you, Prime.
All right. If y'all haven't even noticed or whatever like that, but we'd like to appreciate why I would ask, you know, everybody go ahead, y'all. It's already up on the committee Twitter page. So y'all go ahead and do that. Go ahead and do what y'all got to do with it. But I want to let everybody know. I'm about to turn all this stuff down.
I was going to say your audio just scrambled up.
Yeah, it's just a little scrambled.
It is. All right. Hold on 1 second.
All right.
Is the bag that one now?
No, still a little scrambled.
Still a little scrambled? All right.
I don't know what you turned on. You just jacked up something.
Well, yeah, your audio's a little off.
I'll fix it. Well, you know what? Go ahead, Ryan. Go ahead and take that. Let me go ahead and fix this. I'll be right back.
Go ahead, Ryan. Do your thing, man.
All right. So basically what I'm going to talk about is I'm going to compare the communities between NBA 2K and NBA Live. All right, so for instance, what NBA 2K does is they have like a showcase basically called NBA 2K TV. And so on the NBA 2K TV, what they do is they showcase a variety of different things such as plays, top players. Basically, what they do is they try and get the community involved more with the game. And so basically what I would like to see is I would like to see Live get more involved with the community, such as getting more players involved with the game, showcasing more players. Like I see a lot of players starting out Live Run League. So something like that would be pretty good to get people outside the game to get more interested in the franchise. So that's one thing I would like to see more.
I would like to elaborate upon that. That's a very interesting factoid. There's nothing like word of mouth and community stimulation to get your product out to the forefront. What Ryan is discussing is we feel as a community for the NBA Live franchise that NBA Live does not show enough confidence in their product because they do not reach out to their community that supports their game and put their items of support into the public eye for others to see who may not know what NBA Live is. You know why EA Sports reach out so desperately to 2K individuals when they do decide to stream NBA Live? That's because they have a large audience. And we're going to talk about this later on into the show. Trust me, this is just the tip of the iceberg. But they have a large audience, and they have an opportunity to broadcast the game to eyes onto individuals who may not be aware of what NBA Live is in detail, because word of mouth is very powerful, and people will not purchase a product based upon what they hear instead of what they see. And there are individuals who legitimately gave the game a chance and just made a decision not to purchase the product, not to play it at all. However, based upon the amount of sales, whatever number it may be now, that's still a relatively small number. But you notice as a result of Los Pollos streaming NBA Live, a lot of individuals decide to buy it because they say, yo, the Live Ultimate Team is not bad. Yo, this is fire. It's lit. Blase, blase. Everything else of the sort. Well, EA Sports NBA Live, that is partly your fault. There isn't enough effort in your company to put your game out to the public eye to even understand what your game modes are. A lot of people are coming into my stream and asking me, what is Rising Star? I'm like, really? You don't know what Rising Star is? Rising Star is a NBA Live version of My Player. What is Live Ultimate Team? Live Ultimate Team is NBA Live's version of 2K My Team. What is Pro-Am? You know 2K got Pro-Am too. This is a marketing error. This is a marketing and a management error, because when you come into my streams and I give a legit education of what Pro-Am is, NBA Live 16 has the legit Pro-Am in true detail, down to its players that participated in these summer leagues last year. the failure is translating the info onto the demographic of individuals that you seek to buy your product into them to let them understand what Pro-Am is. To this day, a lot of people do not genuinely know what Pro-Am is because it is an underground form of basketball, okay, that includes true amateur players. Listen to this, rising stars, okay? A lot of players that are in the Pro-Am League throughout the summer are rising stars. They're either seniors going into a top college school, or they're either college players getting ready to enter into the NBA itself or some type of D-League. For example, Emmanuel Mudjai was in Brooklyn Park's Pro-Am last year. He's a rookie now, and he plays for the Denver Nuggets. But nobody knows about that. It is up to EA Sports to educate their fan base upon the modes that you're getting ready to introduce, so there's no speculation and there is no misinformation that would deter individuals from not buying your product. That's issue number one, and Ryan nailed it on the head. Ryan,
right, and hold on. Another thing I noticed that's probably one of the reasons why NBA 2...
No.
Oh.
Yo, froze up.
In mid conversation. I can hear him. He cutting in and out.
I can't
He'll
hear
be
him.
Back. He'll be back. He'll be back with his focus or whatever. So
let me talk about what you just said about ahead, them not knowing their features.
Right.
One thing I've done for years, I did great marketing for people, companies, and stuff like that.
There you go, Ryan.
There we go. Ryan, continue what you were saying, then I'll finish. Go ahead.
Yeah, what I was talking about is what I really think is, I think NBA 2K unbanned him because he had so much of an outreach and they started seeing so many people starting to buy live just off his streams that they were like, oh, this is giving more momentum to live.
Y'all must be talking about Los Polos.
Yeah, that's what I'm talking about. And that's just one streamer. Imagine if multiple NBA 2K streamers started doing that.
Yeah. Right. Actually, this is the thing. Okay, continue, Prime. I'm sorry. Go ahead.
This is what I want to bring to that. Good thing y'all talking about this topic. Oh my God, dang! I forgot about that stuff. What I was gonna say about that, because I'm gonna put it like this: I dropped into Los Polo stream the one night, and I'm gonna tell you and y'all making great points. I dropped in tonight. He was talking about on his stream, and I watched it. I watched like the first maybe 25 minutes of it. And what he said was that when he got banned, he couldn't get on because he couldn't get on. He had to get a brand new PlayStation 4, some stuff like that. They wouldn't let him get on or something like that, or something get reset or something like that. But anyway, he came back. I guess he picked up his son or whatever like that. They came back, and when they came back, they boot up his system. Now, he was playing live at the time, okay? But back to the point where they're saying is that a lot of people was liking the LUT. But then you had a lot of people saying, well, are you ever going to go back to 2K? Are you ever going to play 2K? I knew that he was going to go back to 2K. It was just a matter of time if he was going to actually do it. However, they was actually liking the LUT, and a lot of cats was buying live because of that exposure, okay? And that's a good thing because of that. It's not the only bad thing about it is that it would suck greatly, and it's so jacked up. You got all the guys that got a lot of exposure, or they got a lot of subs, or they got a lot of followers, or they got whatever the hell that it is. They are 2K cats. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? So, but the primary demographic of the live community is not there. The only one that was really, really up there like that was Flight, and he was erratic. So, I mean, you got to take that into consideration. I mean, Flight. Now, I'm going to be honest. I don't care if nobody get mad at me about it. Whatever. Y'all probably already knew what I was talking about anyway. Y'all really, really think that he would be actually a good face for the live community? Seriously? No, I don't. So, what I'm saying is that I'm not trying to knock on the kid or what he's doing or what he tried to do. But if you really, really, really watch him, he's not really, really trying to show light in a positive light or really, really bring anything forth to the table or whatever like that. So that's my output on that. But back to Los Polos or whatever like that. Okay. We got you. Dang, I lost my train of thought. Back to Los Polos. We already knew that he was going to go back and start streaming 2K again, and he's probably never going to go back to live. But just that little bit of exposure to let everybody see it is a good thing. So I can actually say it's a thin line when people are actually reaching out for the exposure, you know, for that. It's like that, but then at the same time, it's like it's a smack in the face because you're going to get that little exposure, but you're not going to continue it. You know what I mean? That's the bad thing. So, you know, say, go ahead, Shadow. What you was going to say? Whoever, which one?
All right. So, basically, first I want to say EA, I'm still pissed at y'all. Y'all made me delete 140-something videos of basketball. I'm going to call y'all out publicly about that in this video because I never say nothing about it. When you have people like me that have channels that have thousands of subscribers that want to promote your product, you copyright flag us. When we're trying to show details of your games and stuff like that. I did, me and Tico, my cousin, well, my brother, basically, Tico, we went in and we did online matches between me and him of live. And we used to go hard on these videos, like go on. It was straight, you know, we was at the buzzer beater who going to win games. EA copyright flagged every video and made me take it down. Even if I did a dispute and tried to keep the videos on YouTube, they flagged them and took them down. They said, we don't care. They're our videos. That's our game. Take it down. Clear as that. They even said it in their paragraph, no, this belongs to us. Take it down. Good and thing. I was just like, this is when I say bad marketing. When we go back to what Swag was saying right now, you don't bring people in that can really push your product out. It's like you're afraid of your own product or people revealing what your product is like. Regardless if your product is incomplete or not, or it's not up to par with the competition, the game elements that you have are so solid. Why are you afraid to demonstrate that and show that? And why are you punishing people for wanting to demonstrate that for you? We're doing free publicity and marketing for you, and you cutting us out of the loop. And I don't understand that because they do a poor job in marketing. I've worked for companies for years, Primeco, Cell Phone, Singular, and I did billboards and everything for them in full graphic detail and brought them shitloads of money. So when you have a company that has a basketball franchise that has less marketing, less recognition, and less money put behind it than a UFC game that has 15,000 times more detail that I've ever seen in player models done in my life. They try to get that accuracy down to the point. It's bad when the crowd models in the UFC game look better than half of live player models. Now, that's pretty bad. I mean, that's just pretty damn bad. I mean, you have a basketball game, an NBA-licensed basketball game of some of the most successful, entertaining this is Kobe's going out year. Live should be advertising in commercials during these games, these Lakers games, and these Cavaliers who are number one in the West right now, whatever, or East right now, they're number one in their division. Every time they show a video, you should have a live commercial advertising those players in those games. Make some commercials. Keep marketing this game. Problem is you don't see that, but you damn sure see 2K. They'll show a 2K commercial every 5 minutes on NBA TV on the League Pass and stuff like that. Where's the live content? It's like there's no effort, man. I mean, where is the effort? Live 16 is not bad. Over the holidays, I encouraged, and I encouraged over 34 friends to play NBA Live. Not only to play it, but to purchase it while it was dropped down to $19.99 and $24.99 during the holiday. Every last one of my friends that bought that game still be online every night playing that game. Well, shit, they did till the division came out, then they forgot it existed. But... but I ain't gonna lie. Up to the division release, you know, they were playing the hell out of live every night. And believe it or not, seven of them are females. Seven of them female. So live is not even a gender thing. It's just you ain't putting it out there for people to recognize it. There's women and men that love sports games. You just got to be able to present that game out there. And these girls and guys are buying the shit out of it because now it's word of mouth. Exactly. It shouldn't take word of mouth. It should take you marketing, producing, commercial. Now, we were talking about the mocap earlier, which we said we were going to get into that. I was looking at some of the motion capture about, you know, they motion capture some random guy. They got some of the Globetrotters and stuff like that. And all I see is a bunch of movement of two short-ass guys in suits. They both like 2 point guards, you know, puckling with each other and they doing some terrible crossovers and, you know, losing the ball and stuff like that. Why don't you have professionals doing these dribble moves and doing these crossovers and stuff like that? If you're going to bring it back correctly. If you ever look at those guys' body styles and those suits, it's like we're going to take these short-ass guys with these weird-shaped bodies so they can fit in these suits, let them motion capture them, and if we need a 6'7 guy or a 6'11 guy, we're going to just stretch their player models, you know, give them a slimmer, leaner body, but it'd be the same guy, same motion capture. And that's what it actually looked like they're doing. If you actually go back and watch all them video, I watched about four or five of them early on some other guy's video. He put them all together and slowed them down. And I'm like, I appreciate they're bringing motion capture back because it's well needed. But I want to see how that's going to fall into an actual in-game when they put the graphics around that. You know what I'm saying? How is that going to...
Good question. That's a real good question because I was thinking about that too with the mocap. See, the only thing a lot of people don't realize is that they still haven't even done 5-on-5 interactions yet. Mm-hmm. They just did individual, just getting the motion and the movements, you know? And, you know, the main thing is that we need to find out about the 5-on-5 interaction. That is the key element of how that, you know, the 5-on-5, you know, interaction is actually going to be. And, you know, I said this a couple of days ago, and I brought this up. I told everybody as well is that, and I said this in my video as well. I said that it's not that Live don't have signature in the game. Mm-hmm. They have certain elements of signature. They just don't have a lot of it, just not like the competition. Yeah. So they don't have it. They don't have it. It's not like they don't have signature guys because all the signature that's in the game are all from their cover athletes, which is very, very ironic because you got to look at it like this. They got Kevin Durant to a T. How did they get Kevin Durant? He was a cover boy of NBA Elite. So they got everything of him in already. They already have all that stuff there. They got Kyrie Irving. They got Westbrook. You know, they got some other cats that's, you know, mo-capped already that they have. So they have a couple. They got Chris Bosh. They got a couple of cats. They got signature in there. They just don't have everybody. You know,
they don't have Steph Curry.
Right. They don't even have Steph Curry signature stuff yet.
You see Steph Curry on the competition game shoot a shot. The moment he hit that, you see that nigga shimmy dance and everything. He be killing it. Keep moving.
Yeah. You know, now maybe they their interactions or their celebrations, they have it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they got Steph Curry's celebration in certain elements, but they don't have, it's not full signature. So don't just say that Live don't have signature in their game because they do. It's just not as much as the competition. Okay?
Well, let me elaborate upon this as well. And I stated this in past shows also about the signature gameplay that is existing in NBA Live 16. There is signature gameplay, however, it's the definition and vocabulary of the gameplay that is supposed to be expressive in signature is so limited that you don't sense it. But it's there. You have to actually look meticulously into the gameplay to fine point things that are in the game that is signature. For example, for those of you who do not know, some of you might. If you play with Memphis and you score with Mike Conley, I want you to pay attention to the stadium sound. You will get the classical beep beep sound for Mike Conley that, you know, that is made for him in that stadium in Memphis when he scores a basket. If you play with the Atlanta Hawks and you dunk the ball, the siren will go off if you play with the Atlanta Hawks and you successfully dunk the ball. So, but the thing is that the signature is limited, whereas 2K16 has worked extensively to make sure that the vocabulary of signature is well-defined and well-described and brought out to the forefront to where you can't miss it. However, it's not emphasized enough in Live 16, and this is an aspect of developmental process that should be one of their first points in gameplay development, which we mentioned before, which was core signature gameplay. Another thing, when it comes down to motion captioning, it's impossible to get every NBA person into the studio to do mocap. So what do? They hire an individual who can imitate them to the closest. Mm-hmm. Now, 2K16 has confirmed, and we've seen videos of this, the mocap that you have for Steph Curry, he's the cover athlete for 2K16, that is Stephen Curry's mocap.
Yeah.
You've seen it. You saw the videos of it. That is definitely confirmed. However, every other individual, that person imitated their moves, okay? That mocap was done by one particular person who knows how to imitate these NBA players' moves. So mocap is classically done by an individual who has the capacity, usually a playground individual, usually some individual who's really skilled at imitating players in the league, to come in and put signature into the game. However, NBA Live have to utilize resources to reach out to these individuals that exist out there in the playgrounds who know how to do these basic moves. You know, some moves that are rather basic, like a wrap around the back, a crossover, dribble gathers between the legs. There's people out there in the pro-am, and better yet, go to Hoop Mixtape. Go to ballislife.com on YouTube. You find them out there. Call them up, bring them in, say, we want you to do this move because you know how to pull off this Kyrie Irving sham gun really well. We want to capture that for you. We'll pay you this amount for the Kyrie Irving mocap. You record that sham gun, mocap, you record it, you're done. You know, those are things that you can do. And there you go. You see what I'm saying? So, and that's beautiful video by my man B Shadows, and that further elaboration as to what goes on into the studios when they do their mocap sessions. It's very detailed. It's very graphic. NBA Live will not go into full detail as to what they do with their mocap, but that what they have done through DG Basketball 2, Derek Grant, is show us that they are introducing mocap and that they are working upon it. Okay, so that's a positive thing. Whereas in NBA Live 16, the only items that we saw in development for NBA Live 16 with mocap was nothing but Russell Westbrook and them capturing his emotionalism, some of the things that he do as far as celebratory wise, but not in detail with gameplay and not in detail with 5v5 mocap. So, you know, we will see these things being implemented as we get closer and closer to the release of NBA Live 17. However, the progress in mocap, and there you go, Russell Westbrook. It's just nothing but Russell Westbrook, okay? Yeah. So that's the only mocap that they've done, you know, however, speculatory-wise. Now, if they did more than that, we just don't know. However, that is definitely confirmed with Russell Westbrook. You see that? And that's a very good YouTube video. You can find all these things in YouTube if you want to do your research. So, positively speaking here, I am encouraged with the fact that they are emphasizing mocap, that they're emphasizing utilizing players from the Harlem Globetrotters who are skilled enough to kind of pull off some of these maneuvers. Even though the initial video that was captured on Twitter via DG Basketball 2 was a little shaky, however, these mocap sessions are quite extensive. They're very there's painstaking. They take hours upon hours to make sure that they get the scene right. It's like running a movie. You know, they don't just do the maneuver once. They run the take over and over and over again meticulously until they feel that they have captured the right sequence. So, you know, don't judge based upon what you initially see. However, they're just letting us know and making us aware of the fact that mocap will be a primary concern and a primary form of development for player movement. There you go, Steph Curry, confirmed. And you see it in the game, a primary form of movement for NBA Live 17. All right. Anybody else want to chime in upon that? I also want to chime in upon... I also want to chime in upon the community's response for the developmental team of NBA Live reaching out to Los Pollos and many individuals from the 2K community for their feedback. I want to bring my opinion about that, but I'm going to let you guys chime on in onto something else if you guys want to elaborate upon another item of subject of discussion.
Now, hold on. We got to get We got to get the quietest man in here to start speaking.
Yeah, let's go. Go ahead, Seth.
Ryan, you supposed
not Ryan. I'm not the professor. He's the only one being quiet.
Let's go back to the mocap thing. The mocap thing to me is the situation of the Players Association. Due to the new CBA, these players are not really obligated to come in and do mocap. Because me and Prime, remember, we studied the old CBA and the new CBA. What the old CBA is that these players were obligated by the Players Association to perform these mocap sessions with video games. So the reason why we have Globetrotters or Playground guys is because of the new CBA. Like I said, under the new CBA, these players are not contractually obligated to do this. They can. That's the reason why these companies had to pay X amount of dollars to these players, where before they didn't have to pay X amount of dollars to these players. So that's the reason why we have, like I said, Globetrotters and Playground guys doing mocap. So, you know, basically, I mean, you know, if we get lucky to have a few NBA guys come in and do some mocap, okay, I'll take that.